Now I'm going to start discussing what's actually usually most interesting for you is modeling. The modeling is really what you do, you know, when you have to solve a problem, or if you use a commercial code or the code of someone else. This guy had to answer the questions which I'm going to work on now, which is how do you model turbulent flames in practice? What do? You know, after explaining it's complicated, etc., etc., you still need to do something. You cannot just argue that it's tough and not do anything. So I mentioned that yesterday. All these flames are 3D time-dependent flows. So we cannot really expect to compute all of this. We need to make assumptions. The first assumption, which started a long time ago, was to look only for averages. That means we say we are not going to compute all turbulent eddies, we're going to compute only the main eddies. So that's an example of LES simulations where you have a flow stabilized, a flame stabilized here on the wedge, and you can see the hot gases, and the black line is the reaction rate. And if you measure temperature at a point here, you're going to find a turbulent signal, and we hope that in LES we're going to capture at least the large structures. If you compute only the average, we're going to compute only this quantity, right? Of course, it's much easier to compute the average than to compute this thing. And of course, computing the DNS part would be very, very difficult, and we are not going to touch that. So the first thing I want to discuss is the classical Lorentz method, where we're going to try to compute only the average part. And you will see that already that is an interesting exercise. Now, just to remind you of the classification of the methods, DNS resolve all scales at a very high price and can do only cubic boxes, basically. Lorentz can compute complicated flow, and LES is in between. For example, this is the same flame computed with Lorentz and with LES. And this is a typical example. You can recognize Lorentz very easily. When you look at the Lorentz computation, it's smooth everywhere. It has no gradients, no vortices. When you look at an LES flow, you recognize things which look like eddies. They should be there. Large eddy simulation. If there is no eddy in your simulation, it's not an LES. I see a lot of people who do LES which look like this. You know, that's what I call an LES without eddy. You want to be careful. When you move from a Lorentz code to LES, the first thing you must learn to do is movies. I know it looks like a joke, but it's very important. Please make movies of your flow and check that it's moving. I will give you examples tomorrow explaining why it's very easy to do an LES which is completely wrong, where there is no turbulence. And that's extremely, of course, dangerous because you're going to pay a high price, but you're going to get a bad result. Okay, time averaging. If you're not in a system where you're looking at a steady flame, you have to imagine that what you do is cycle averaging. This is a computation in an engine where you're looking here at 8 cycles. They're supposed to be all the same, but you see in practice they're all different. So if you're doing a computation of an engine with a Lorentz simulation, what you're doing really is you're supposed to compute the mean of all cycles. There's only one, and it's the mean. If you do LES, you're going to compute each cycle differently, and of course, if you do LES, you're supposed to be able to capture the variability of cycles. If you're doing Lorentz, since you compute the average cycle, it doesn't have to change. So that's a major limitation, of course, in Lorentz, but this is what is done if you're using Lorentz code. There's another average I want to mention for those who are doing DNS. It's a spatial average. For example, if you do a DNS like this one, this flow is homogeneous in this direction and in this one. So it makes sense to average like this, you know. You take a plane, and the plane, you average everything in this plane, in this section, this position, then you move it to another one, and you go in this direction. And this gives you something which is an average temperature profile as a function of the distance normal to the flame. Okay? And this is the way you average DNS in many cases. Now, by the way, I want to say that LES and Lorentz have a big difference. When you're going to do Lorentz, what we're really going to do is we're going to average a signal over time. So you put your hand in the engine and you measure temperature, not your hands, something else, and you just plot the average of that. When you do LES, it's very different. You're not doing that. You're not averaging over time. You're averaging over space. You put your hands in the system, and you look at all the temperatures around this point with a certain filter. For example, it can be a simple box. You take all the points which are close to your point, and you do the average of that. So this is really a spatial averaging. We call it also space filtering operation, while WANS is doing a time averaging operation. In practice, in the code, you will see that doesn't make so much of a difference. But in the theory, of course, it's not the same. Now, which kind of filter do you use? Well, in LES, you know, you have in spectral space, it's a very fancy name, just to say that in practice, in physical space, this is what you do. You average all data at a distance of delta around you, delta over 2 around you. It can be also a Gaussian filter. The funny thing is that you can use the filter you want. It doesn't appear in the code anyway. I will show you in a minute why. But people like to talk about that. But in practice, that doesn't change the lines in your code. Now, first problem. Favre, another French guy, and Reynolds average, English, I guess. Independently of LES or WANS, there's a problem with density. Those of you who have done aircraft computations, they don't care because density is constant, so you don't have to worry about it. If you do a combustion case, density, of course, is changing. So if you just want to use Reynolds averaging, this is the way you're going to do it. You're going to say density at any point and any time is equal to a mean value plus a perturbation. Okay? And of course, this is a constant, and the average of rho prime is zero. If I take the average of this equation, I take rho bar equal rho bar bar, but this is a constant, so it doesn't change. And here you have rho prime bar, so it has to be zero so that you balance this equation. Same thing for the velocity. Then you plug these two equations in this one, and you take the average of that. It's something I haven't said. Since we're going to be looking for average quantities, how do we get them? Well, there's a logical way to do it. We're going to average the instantaneous equations. Makes sense, huh? So we're going to average the instantaneous equations to find solutions for the average value. So you take the average of this equation here, so you put a bar here, and you develop it. So you end up very rapidly with this equation. D over dt of rho bar, you could say, hey, you just say that rho bar was constant. Well, if you have cycle averaging, you have to keep this term. You have to, in a piston engine, for example, this term won't be zero. And here, in this term, you keep only two terms. There are four, normally. You see, you put rho here, u here, you develop that. There will be four terms. But when you take the average of rho bar by u prime is zero, and the average of u bar by rho prime is zero, too. So you end up with only two terms, but you end up with a term here. So this is rho bar ui bar plus rho prime u prime bar. And here, for the first time, we see our problem. This is what we call an unclosed term, a correlation term, which doesn't have to be zero. The perturbation of density and the perturbation of velocity, they don't have to be completely uncorrelated. So this term could be non-zero. But the worst problem is that we're going to write a code where our variables are going to be the mean density and the velocity. And we would like this code to conserve mass. That would be fun, you know, because, for example, if we work with this equation, we can have an engine where we have a flow rate of 2 kilograms per second at the inlet and 2.2 at the outlet, because this is not conserving mass. We have an additional term here. So people saw that, actually Favre saw that, I don't know, a long time ago, and people said, it's going to be a pain. We're going to have a code where mass is not conserved. I mean, how are we going to explain that? So Favre said, well, let's move to a different average. Method, averaging method, which is called today the Favre averaging. I don't know if he gave his name at that time. So it's tilde. So tilde is, instead of taking the time average of f, you take the time average of rho f divided by rho bar, which is a weighted average. What does the weighted average mean? It's like when you go to an election, right, in certain countries like this, if you're rich, you can put more votes, you know. It's just this. So here, if you're heavy, you're more important. This is exactly what you're doing, okay? If you're heavy, your part is going to have more weight than the light guys. Okay? Why do we do that? Well, it's a mass-weighted average. It's not demiquatic, but it has a big advantage. This guy conserves mass. I'm going to show you in a minute, because this guy is such that if you have the average of rho multiplied by anything, it's equal to the mean of rho multiplied by f tilde. So if you, again, take this equation and you put averages on top of it, since rho f average is equal to rho bar f tilde here, you end up with this equation for the average quantity. Now, good news, this thing conserves mass, of course. Careful, right away, it means that when using Favre averaging, when you're using Fluent or any code you have, the density is Reynolds averaged. It's the only one which is like this. And all the others are Favre averaged. Not a good start, okay? Because if you want to compare to the experiment, the Favre averaging and Reynolds averaging for an experimentalist don't mean much. It's going to give you the average. How did you average? Well, I don't know. I just average what I can, you know? And you will see actually it's very complicated in an experiment to know if you're computing a Reynolds average or a Favre average. So, again, do what you can. People work with Favre average, all of them. Okay, well, not all of them. There was one guy in Toulouse tried not to do that for a few years, but 99% of the community works with Favre averaging all the time. It's already complex like that. Now, what does it really mean? You know, every time you write a Favre average, you can actually show that the Favre average is equal to the Reynolds average plus a correlation. So when you tell to someone my mean temperature, Favre average temperature is 1,000 K, it really means that you are incorporating some kind of model here. You don't tell the guy, but obviously there is a model here that's hidden behind it. And so it's going to be a big problem, of course, when we're going to compare two experiments. Because if you want to compare, we need to know which average we have been using. So in an experiment, we don't really know. It's difficult for them to say. There are certain systems like laser doublet velocimetry where the sampling seems to depend on the density. So if you do the average of an LDV system, you're not very far from Favre averaging. If you do PIV, then really you do Reynolds averaging. And so in practice, when we're going to want to compare measurements and simulations, it will be a problem. You could say, OK, it wouldn't be a problem if the Favre average and the Reynolds average would be the same, of course. But you're going to see in a minute that they are not the same. They can be quite different. So how do we know that? Again, and I hope when you leave this school, you will remember that COE. COE everywhere. COE is the only guide you have. If you lose COE, you're lost. It's just, so COE again helps you here. So how do we use COE? There's a very famous model in the world of turbulent combustion, which is the Bue-Moss-Libby model. And Bue-Moss and Libby were the guys who looked at this problem and they had a big change. They didn't have any computer and didn't have any experiment. So they had to think about it. So they say, well, if you measure temperature at a point like this in a premix flame, we know, because they were theoreticians, we know that the thickness of the flame front has to be small. If it's a laminar flame, it's a few fraction of a millimeter. So basically, when I measure temperature at a point like this, the signal must look like this. Either I see cold gases here, or I see burn gases. And here, when I'm sitting here, the only thing I'm seeing here is the internal structure of the flame, which is very small. So these times here should be very small in a signal like this. So the signal should actually look like that. It's like a telegraphic signal, if you will. And the only assumptions you need in the BML model to go there is to say the flame front are thin. As soon as you say that, you get this sign of signal. And this signal is enough, as soon as you say that, it's enough to show the links between, for example, Favre averaging and Reynolds averaging. And we're going to do that right away. If we call TU the time where you have here cold gases, and to make that simple, in the turbulent combustion community, I should have said it, we start by using all the assumptions we've used in the premix flame. We say Lewis equal unity, we say it's adiabatic, so we define the progress variable theta, which is going from zero in the fresh gases to one in the burned gases. And so the signal of theta is just this kind of telegraphic signal, equal to zero during the total time TU, equal to one during the total time TB. Okay? Couldn't be more simple. So you can compute the mean temperature, okay? So it's going to be TU multiplied by zero during the time it's zero, plus TB multiplied by 1 divided by TU plus TB. So the mean temperature is just TB over TU plus TB. That's easy. And so that would be the Reynolds average temperature, right? You see also, by the way, something about the mean temperature in a system like this. It's a premixed flame. You see that we call that a mean temperature, but actually it's more like a probability of having a flame at a given point. Because the mean temperature is never seen. You never have the mean temperature there. What you have is one or zero. And so if you would work in the probabilistic world, you would call that the probability to have burned gases at one point. If it's one, it means you are in the burned gases. If it's zero, you're in the fresh gases. And so it also tells you something when you interpret results of model. We call that mean temperature. It would be better to call them probabilities of having burned gases. And again, that means really that if you have a mean temperature of 1600 K somewhere, it really means that the probability to have burned gases is 59%, if the fresh gases have 300 temp and the burned gases 2500. That's the good way to look at the results of an average simulation, because you really don't access these things, you just get the mean of it. And as we will mention that, we'll talk about flame wall, don't use this information to guess if your walls are going to live or die, because it doesn't tell you much about the real temperature of the walls. But now you can do more. Since we have this model for the Fav average, for the Reynolds average, we can compute the Fav average. The Fav average is the same, except that instead of computing the mean of temperature, we compute the mean of rho multiplied by the temperature. So now it's going to be TU multiplied by rho U plus TB multiplied by rho B divided by TU plus TB. And if you scale it, you end up with this expression. And you can actually compute, so this is the mean density, and this is the mean density multiplied by temperature. And you do the ratio of these two, you get the Fav average. And so the Fav average end up like theta tilde is equal to that, where tau here is the ratio of the unburned gases to the burned gases minus 1. So tau is like 7 or 6 or 8, depending on the flame. And so you can revert it, write it like this. But you see that if tau is 0, this term goes away, and Reynolds average and Fav average are the same. Great. But your tau in your flames is not 0. Your tau are more like 10. What's happening if you have 10? Well, this is what's going on here. If you plot the Fav average, and here if you plot the Reynolds average, and here you have the no heat release, they're equal, but here you see the difference between, for example, a typical case with 10 here. If the Fav average is 0.4, the Reynolds average is 0.8, which is in the real world mean that the Fav average would be 1600 and the other one would be 1000. There would be a 500-600 K difference between the two. So it's important to know if you are computing a Fav average or a Reynolds average. Just an example here, again, in the Prekinstar burner, which we computed here, we looked not at temperature, we looked at velocities. And there's a good news about this thing, is that the difference between Reynolds and Fav average is only important in the flame zone. When you are in a zone where you only have burned gases, or if you are in a zone where you only have fresh gases, there's no problem, because density is constant. So the problem will occur only here. And here we plotted, for example, the difference between U tilde minus U bar, and you see that it's important in this zone. And in this zone, that means if you compare measurements and simulation, in this zone, if it doesn't work, you can claim it's not my fault, it's the difference between Fav and Reynolds averaging. It's not going to work everywhere. Okay, you can use this thing not everywhere. Now, for example, here, in those regions where there's no flame, that the averaging should work. And here you have the simulation, and here you have the experiment, and here you have an estimate of the maximum errors you can have. You can see the length of this arrow is an estimate of the uncertainty due only to the fact that you don't know if you are computing Reynolds or Fav averaging. I'm not talking about experimental margin or LES problems, mesh, whatever. Before we talk about that, just because of averaging, we can have problems in the flame zone. So wherever the flame is in these regions, for example, that can explain that you're not comparing the same thing. So you cannot expect it to be equal. Now, the BML model was a big topic for a long time. I don't know maybe how many students worked on that. So they worked on a lot of things. Let me show you another one, which we adapted here for LES and for RANS. We are not interested only about the mean. I've told you many times that the mean is interesting, but the fluctuations are more interesting. But then you have to worry about fluctuations. Are we talking about Favre fluctuations or Reynolds fluctuations? Well, then you start asking nasty questions. First question is, what do you really compare? When you do an LES, the results are filtered in space. They vary over time. So then, if you want to compare to an experiment, you have to average over time the LES results. When you average over time the LES results, you could do it using Favre averaging, or you could do it using Reynolds averaging. That gets tricky. In general, we use Reynolds averaging of the Favre data. We don't want to do Favre two times. These rich guys, they've voted already, okay? You've done already the Favre averaging, you don't want to repeat it. So what we do usually, we take averaging time of space average results. When you do an experiment, here, it's not clear what you do. Again, in PIV, you have an experimental resolution, and then you time average the results. And also the question is, can you commute all these operators? And here, there's a good news somehow, is that you can actually. You can show that you can filter in space and average in time, or you can average in space and filter in time, and the average values are going to be the same. So normally, if you forget the zones which are here near the flame, normally you should be able to compare experiments and LES in terms of mean values. But that's only for the mean. When you start looking at the fluctuation, for example, you compute the variance of F. Okay, I'm not sure here who is familiar with turbulence models. Can you raise your hands if you have played with turbulence modeling before? How many of you have played? Not enough. Okay, this notation here, it's the average of F square minus the square of F. That's what we call the variance in the turbulence world. If the system is constant, it's zero. And if the system is not constant, it's going up. And it's, you could also call it F prime square average. So it measures really the intensity of the fluctuations. So when this thing goes up, you have a lot of turbulence. When it's zero, you have no turbulence. We must predict this thing. You will see why we need it. We need to know this thing. But this thing has a funny property. If you expand it, this is what I've done here, the true variance of your signal is equal to what you resolve with LES plus a subgrid scale variance. And then, right away, it tells you that if you compute the variance with LES of your velocity field, and you want to compare it to the variance measured with LDV, for example, they don't have to match. There's a model in between, which is what we call the subgrid scale variance. And that really means that you cannot compare them directly. So what you must have is that the experimental variance must be more than the LES variance. Between in between, you have the subgrid scale kinetic energy. If you are above it, then you have a problem. But in many LES, that's actually true for non-reacting cases, this is the way you should find your system. You should have less variance in your LES because you don't have the subgrid scale terms there than you have in your real system. So by the way, this tells you also that you can do LES, which is good, but when you want to compare two experiments, if you don't know about these things, and if you don't know that you have to worry about these things, you're going to have problems. Okay, I finished now with this averaging question. I want to start discussing the modeling. How do we really model these things? I'm going to do models for premix flames and models for diffusion flames because they are different. And you will see it's a problem, actually, because we use different models for different flames. But if you have a flame which mixes different regimes, we are in trouble. So averaging is the same. We're going to take equations for average quantities by averaging the instantaneous equations. So we start by the instantaneous Navier-Stokes equations, and we take averages. And we take Favre averaging. So we're going to take any quantity, and we're going to time average and formulate it as an Favre average. The first thing to say here is that independently of whether you use Favre or Reynolds averaging, remember that if you take the average of a constant multiplied by theta, you can get the constant out. Okay, that's clear. And that's the only thing which is clear. After that, every correlation of that type, when you multiply two quantities and you take the average, they don't have to be equal to the average of the quantities. And the most extreme example is the reaction rate. The reaction rate averaged is not equal to the average of the mean temperature. For a nonlinear function, if from a mathematical point of view it's clear, I will show that with hands in a few minutes. Okay, the procedure is the following. We're going to take the instantaneous conservation equations, we're going to average them. And once we have averaged them, we should end up with a closed system. That means a system where the only variable in our problem are the mean density, the mean Favre average velocity, the mean temperature, full and pressure. If we have something else, we're in trouble. Because it's not a variable that we know. We must write a code where we can express all the terms as a function of this. And the problem will be that the averaging procedure will make new terms arrive, and these terms will have to be modeled. So to begin, we're going to again rely on the same assumptions we used for premixed flames, for laminar flames. We're going to say the Lewis number is unity. We have a single step reaction for the moment. Again, you can see we are far away from the real world. We say constant pressure, so it's really deflagration, low speed. And you're going to say the flow is adiabatic. When you say all that, according to what we've done yesterday and what you've heard from Paul, you can work with only one progress variable, which tells you how combustion goes from 0 to 1 in the fresh to the burned gases. The instantaneous equation for that have been derived yesterday. So I'm showing you now the average equation. So this is the average continuity equation. I've derived it 2 minutes ago. Okay, you recognize the rho bar ui tilde here. If you do the same thing for momentum, you find something which is the same. And if you do it for temperature, you find this one. Now, how do we arrive here? I'm going to show you how you do that. But by the way, you have to recognize where these terms come from. This term here is written ui average, uj average, because those are the variables we need in our code. But when this term was developed, it had this thing here. And this thing has been thrown out of the left-hand side and added to the right-hand side. I'll show you how later, because this is one thing we don't know. We do the same thing for temperature. We have here an additional term, which is ui tilde. Well, not tilde, it's a double prime. It's the perturbation of velocity multiplied by the perturbation of temperature averaged. And so you see, by the way, two types of term appearing. If we wouldn't have these things here, we'd be fine. But we have them, so we have to do something about it. We cannot work with them. We have to express them as function of the average quantities. This term here is usually called turbulent diffusion. You will see why. It's not a turbulent diffusion, but since we're going to model it as a diffusion, people wanted to call it turbulent diffusion. And this is the mean reaction rate. And in the literature on premixed flames, we have burnt thousands of PhD students on these two problems. Okay, it's been awful. Because, of course, the question now, if we cannot model these terms, we cannot close this equation. So we need to do something about these terms. Let's start with the turbulent transport. Now, as I said, the people who are a little bit too sensible should leave the room, because I'm going to show you the first turbulent combustion model. It hurts, OK? Let me tell you. I'm going to model this guy. Okay, I'm going to replace theta by C, because in the community you find the English call it theta, the French call it C, but whatever. So it's this term, rho, perturbation of velocity, perturbation of C, everything averaged. How do you model that? You have no idea how to model it. That's the truth. So you have to find something. So the way you do a model in turbulent combustion is to say, okay, this is the mean flame. So here you have the cold gases, here you have the burned gases, this is space, and this is the mean flame front. And this is C tilde. This is a quantity which is a quantity of my code. So this one I know. I want to express things here as a function of C. Okay, well, the first thing you know is that very far away in the fresh gases, there are no fluctuation of C. So you know that this term is zero. And here, it's the same thing. Very far away in the burned gases, C is equal to one, so its perturbation is zero. So this term is zero. So you say, OK, I have something which is zero here, something which is zero there. What else do I have which is zero on both sides? Well, of course, here it's not zero, but the gradient of C, dC average over x, has the same property. So it's equal. That's a model. So that's what we call identification. You know? Since both this quantity and the gradient of C are zero on both sides, we're going to say they're equal. that's the basis of turbulent diffusion models. And I know it's awful, but that's the way it works. The second thing you like to have for a model, it should have the right sign. So you see that this thing, you need to put a minus here. And why do you need to put a minus? Well, it comes from the following idea. If you're sitting here, this is a turbulent flame front. You have to imagine you have vortices here. Remember, it's turbulent. If you see normally a C perturbation which is positive, that means you see a point here which is hot. What are you going to think? Do you think it's going to come from this side or from that side? Well, if you're sitting here and you see something hot, you're going to guess it's coming from that side. So if it comes from that side, it has a negative velocity. It's coming in this direction, and vice versa. If you see something colder than the mean, you're probably going to think it's going to be pushed here by a positive thing. So you know that normally if you have C negative, U positive, the correlation will be negative. So we expect this term to be different of zero and to be negative in this zone where the gradient of C is positive. So we put a minus here. That's how you do models. The next thing you need for a model is that it should have the right dimensions. Okay? If you look at this, it doesn't have the right dimensions. How do we make it right? We add here a viscosity. And here we have a constant. You always have a constant here that you can tune later. We call it the turbulent Schmidt number. And turbulent Schmidt numbers can take any kind of values. This is the turbulent viscosity. This is the first time you meet it. So for those of you who have already played with turbulence model, the famous K epsilon model, its goal is to build a turbulent viscosity. Why is it a turbulent viscosity? Because it has the right dimensions so that this model works. Okay. This model is incredibly simple, incredibly stupid, and it's used in 99% of codes. Okay. And we know it's wrong. I'm not sure I've done it here, but we know it doesn't even have the right sign in many cases. Even the sign is wrong. We know that this thing, because when we do DNS, we can measure that, and we can measure that, and we see quite often that even the sign is wrong. But again, that's the way it's done. We model it as a diffusion term with the turbulent viscosity. We still don't know the turbulent viscosity. We'll have to find a model for it and hope that we get a good model, but this is the principle of the model. Now, why did we do that? Well, in practice, you know, if you raise your hand a little bit, raise your eyes on these equations, you see that this term here, it would be nice to model it a little bit like this one. This is what we just did. We have modeled this term a little bit like this one. So when we merge the two now, it's kind of a nice property that the overall model looks like this one. Instead of having here a laminar viscosity, now we have a laminar viscosity plus a turbulent term. And that's cool, because it means if you go in your code, you don't have to change much. In addition to the laminar viscosity, which is here, you add a turbulent term, turbulent viscosity. Easy. So in, you know, it's a magical thing. You don't even have to change your code. And that's the reason why people did it that way 50 years ago. Because they said, well, I have a code doing laminar flow. If I just add here a turbulent viscosity, I'm saved. And this is what a lot of people did. Other people actually said it's a stupid idea. And they went to more sophisticated models, like a second order model, which don't even work better. But this is, again, the community has converged to the best compromise in terms of complexity and precision, which is just to add here a term. Let me just say something right away. If this thing is one, this thing is 1,000. Okay. So you have to remember that. The models, especially for one simulation, that's something that people never do, but if you're using a commercial code, go and take a look at the turbulent viscosity. You will be amazed. This thing is huge. That also explains why in many codes, you can actually drop the laminar viscosity, the laminar diffusion. This is also a discussion which explains why you don't care about the Lewis number. The laminar Lewis number is here. But if this term is 1,000 times smaller than that one, forget it. So if you use a commercial code, which is doing once, it's a joke to talk about the effect of the laminar properties, because they have no effect at all. They are completely dominated by the turbulent terms. That's the first problem. Now, I want to give now a political interpretation of that, which was not due to me, it was due to a famous French guy called Amin. And just to point out how bad this idea was. Okay, the turbulent diffusion term, you can really understand what it's doing by the political interpretation of things. The political interpretation is the following. This term here guy was actually on the left side. So it was, in political terms, it was a left side guy. He was making demonstrations, generating turbulence, you know, acting all the time like a left side people. On the other side, on the right hand side, you got the viscous people. Those guys are dissipating turbulence, you know. This is what you do with turbulence. You dissipate the energy, so you create a vortex, you damp it. So you create, you know, agitation in the society, on the right hand side you damp it. What we did with this guy is that he was on the left hand side, we brought it to the right hand side. That happens quite often. In France we have many of these guys. So he traveled to the right hand side. That's okay. I mean, you can say, okay, depends what you're going to do now when you are on the right hand side. The problem is that when this guy was on the right hand side, he transformed himself into this term, which is a viscous term. And he added itself to this guy here, which was the laminar viscous term. So you see that we have really transformed a term which was creating turbulence into a term which damps turbulence. So it's completely stupid. We have lost the nature of the problem. I will explain why in a short while, but I just want also to mention something which I haven't mentioned yet. Again, maybe I should have done it before. The source of turbulence. How many people here have taken courses on chaos? No one, huh? Yeah, a few of them. Yeah. The source of turbulence comes from chaos, and chaos comes from nonlinearities. If the Navier-Stokes equation would have no nonlinear terms, if everything would be linear, if you wouldn't have products like that one, you wouldn't have turbulence. Everything would be laminar all the time. The history is that if you have here nonlinear multiplications and you take averages of that, these things are the source of chaos. So the system starts, you know, moving in unexpected directions and ultimately of turbulence. And so really, it's this term here, which is now becoming this term. This is really the source of turbulence. We have completely wiped it away here. We have put it in the viscous terms, and we have completely changed the nature of the problem. Now, turbulence is only one additional term here, which is actually a damping term. So we don't expect this thing to be physical, okay? It's bad. But again, people have done it for reasons which I will explain later, and today it's the consensus. Most people do that. So I want to finish by talking about the instantaneous reaction rate. You remember I had two terms. The first one was the turbulent diffusion. I've shown you how it is modeled. It's modeled in the same way in WANS and in LES, actually. It doesn't make a difference. The only difference is that in LES it's going to be much smaller than it is in WANS. I will show you examples of that. Now I want to talk about the instantaneous reaction rate. This is the expression of the instantaneous reaction rate, exactly the same that Paul used yesterday. So this is the fuel mass fraction, 1 minus theta, and the shape of this guy is this thing. No combustion and strong reaction, and here the value here is of the order of 1 minus 1 over beta. And that again comes from asymptotic theory, and this is where, you know, you cannot use KPP, like this Kolmogorov theory, which was discussed yesterday by Paul, that you have to use Zeldovich method to compute these things. Now, these numbers here, alpha, which is here, is of the order of 1, and beta, which is here, is of the order of 10. And we need to take the average of that. Okay. So there are many ways to do that. First thing to do, if you're mathematicians, you recognize that if you need to take the average of a nonlinear quantity, it's difficult. Okay. You expect it to be tough. But you know, if you're a physician, all these questions about mathematics are not interesting. It's better to discuss that in the real world. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to list here the typical models. I'm not going to do all of them now. It's going to take too much time. I want to show you the models which never work first. I want to insist on that because I see too many people and too many commercial codes, Converge, for example, is one of them, trying to explain that these models do work. I'm just going to show you in 5 minutes that it's just impossible. And then we'll go into other models. So, what is the model which doesn't work? Well, the model which doesn't work is to say that the average reaction rate is equal to the reaction rate of the average temperature. In other words, you take the average and you plug it here. Okay? Remember, I had a big bar on top of it, so I just distribute the average here. And to make Favre averaging, I put the... So that's a logical first step. Why is it wrong? Mathematically, We can argue about that. I'd rather do it physically. Come back to this case here. This is the temperature signal. Okay. And this is the reaction rate. The reaction rate is zero when you have cold gases at that point, and it's zero when you have burnt gases. It's only non-zero when you have a passage of the flame here. So the reaction rate looks like spikes here, these green curves. Okay. And this is what you need to average. So we want to know the average of this thing. The average of this thing is probably a blue line somewhere here. Now, if we look at a problem like this one, and we have, for example, this type of flame with a mean quantity, which is this one, and we look at this case where we have the same mean, but with a different distribution, you see right away that they're going to have a very different mean reaction. So it's impossible that the mean reaction rate could be equal to the value of the function at the mean temperature. It's just never going to work because there are so many signals with the same mean which do not give you the same number of passages, which means really don't give you the same amount of mean reaction rate. So you really cannot hope to take this formula and get the mean reaction rate. Of course, if you're doing mathematics, you know how to solve this problem on the paper. You take the mean of this thing, that's an easy exercise. You get an expansion of exponential minus t over t. You say t is equal to t tilde plus all the polynomials of extrapolation to a given order, and you expand that. And that's it's a cute exercise. You end up with that. Okay, you end up here with the mean values, and then you have all the correlations. And actually, the first term here is what I call the no model, the model where you just inject directly the mean into this formula. But then you get all these terms here, additional terms. And these terms are fun. I mean, they are correlations, you know, fuel and oxidizer, fuel and temperature, oxidizer and temperature, etc., etc. And the interesting thing is that when you go in this direction, these corrections increase. I mean, which really means that these terms are larger than this one, which really means that if you start going that way, you have to add terms, you know, and it's a non-converging series. That's what it really means. And so this was also attempted by the people coming from the mathematical community, and they gave up very fast for flames. There are a few cases where these things work, but for flames, that's not going to work. So one example is atmospheric chemistry, where people use expansions like this, supersonic combustion for other reasons I don't want to discuss today. The only model you're going to see in certain codes is to call that what we call the segregation factor, S, which is zero if you have perfect mixing, and if you have full separation, it's minus one. So some people use this first here expression to add another tuning term to their models, but that just doesn't work. Okay, I will finish with the eddy breakup model. That's a great model. It was written by a guy called Spaulding, Brian Spaulding. He actually was one of the first to found companies selling codes, once codes at that time, but he had really a great physical feeling. And this guy said, well, look at this problem. And again, I'm going to build a model like the one I did a few minutes ago, I'm afraid. Huh? He said, here, it's cold. Okay, temperature is equal to zero, but reaction rate is also equal to zero. Here, it's hot. Theta is equal to 1, but reaction rate is also equal to 0 because the flame never goes there. And in the middle, here where the flame moves up and down, I have theta, which is not equal to 0, and I have reaction rate. Okay, so how can I write a model which mimics that? In other words, which kind of quantity can I use which have the same property? 0 here, 0 here, and non-zero here. Well, this is what I'm going to tell you, but there's one thing which goes from 0 to 0 passing by a maximum is the x multiplied by y minus x function. Okay? Actually, you've seen it yesterday in Paul's conference. That's the only way, the simplest way to go from 0 to 1 to 0 is to use a quadratic function of temperature. And this is what we're going to do, except you're going to do it in a little bit more elegant way. So Spaulding said chemistry has no role to first order. What's important is how many times a flamelet crosses a given location. How many times you have here a flame LED passing at the point where you are. So if you want to know the mean reaction rate here, you need to know how many times a flame has passed near the point where you are. And this has to be proportional to the variance of temperature. Okay, why the variance of temperature? Well, the variance of temperature is zero here because it's always cold, it's zero here because it's always hot, and it's non-zero here. So he said, okay, that's a good animal for our model. Let's take the variance of temperature here. And he looked at the dimensions of the model. He said, I need the density and I need the time. The time here is a typical time between two crossing events. So he wrote the model like this, and then he went back to talk to his colleague, Moss and Libby, and he said, if you use the Brain-Moss-Libby model, you can show that the variance of temperature is just equal to theta multiplied by 1 minus theta if you have a telegraphic signal. That's easy to prove. I haven't done it here, but that's quite simple to prove in this equation. So he replaced that in this expression, and he needed the time. So he had a k epsilon code. If you look at k over epsilon, it has the dimension of the time. He said, that's the right time. Okay, good model, okay, if it has the right dimension and the right sign. So he ended up saying that, I don't need to talk about that again. Okay, this is what I've shown you before. The variance is equal to theta multiplied by 1 minus theta. And so in the end, this is the model he got. If you're using a k epsilon model, this is the case in many codes, you're going to have here k over epsilon, so it goes to epsilon over k. Here you have the variance of temperature, theta multiplied by 1 minus theta. You need the density to have the right dimension, and you need a constant. And if you plug that into codes, it works much, much better than the previous model, which is really surprising, but it's really impressive. So the interesting thing is that if you plot now this thing as a function of theta, it doesn't look at all like the laminar reaction rate we had before. Remember, the laminar reaction rate, the reaction rate as a function of theta looks like this. While this function obviously looks like theta multiplied by 1 minus theta, it has a maximum at 0.5. So is it right or not? Well, you go in an experiment and you measure, and this is what you find. You ask an experimentalist to measure the mean reaction rate as a function of the mean progress variable, it's going to give you that, which looks very much like the eddy breakup model and not at all like the no model. So it really tells you that the eddy breakup model, even though it's very simple, it captures something which is really there in the experimental results. So it is a good model. The surprising thing is that we started from this formula. You know, we had chemistry here, we had all kinds of parameters, and suddenly all of them are gone. Where are they? They are all of them in the constant, C eddy breakup. And C eddy breakup is actually not a constant. When you look at papers using the eddy breakup model, people tune it from 1 to 1,000, depending on the cases. they actually publish tables giving you the value of the constant as a function of the case, you know. But it's still better than using the no model, because at least it has the right shape, okay? Of course, the chemistry is gone, but physically, that's a pretty good model. Okay, I'll come back to that tomorrow. I think for today we have enough, so I'll let you have a good evening. See you tomorrow.